Hopefully you went ahead and did the homework. If not, then I'm going to explain it to you now. It turns out that L inverse is itself always a linear transformation. And how do we prove that? Well, we always start with arbitrary x and y and arbitrary alpha. X and y are vectors in Rn. And there are two questions that we need to answer. The first one is it the case that if you multiply x first by alpha and then you invert it, you get the same thing as if you invert first and then you multiply by alpha? Now, how do we prove that? Well, we start by saying we know that L inverse transforms x. Let's call the result of that u. And what we then know about u is that if you put u back into L, you better get x back. Why? Because L is the inverse of L inverse. Now we're ready to ask the question, what does alpha x transformed by L inverse equal? We can replace our x with L times u. That's because of this. And we know that then the alpha can be brought in because L is a linear transformation. And that leaves us with that. But we know that L inverse of L of anything is just that anything. So we know that alpha times u comes back. But we also know that u we define to be L inverse x. So that gives us that right there. And therefore, L inverse of alpha x is equal to alpha times L inverse of x, which is what we wanted. The next thing we need to do is see whether we can add first and then transform, or transform first and then add. Again, we use the same trick. We say that u is equal to L inverse x, and now v is equal to L inverse y, and therefore we know that L of u is x, L of v is y. And then we start plotting away. L inverse of x plus y is the same as plugging in that L of u and L of v is x and y, or x and y respectively. Because L is a linear transformation, we then know that we can add first and transform. We can then use the fact that L inverse is the inverse of L to leave us with L with u plus v. But then we notice that u was defined to be L inverse of x, v was defined to be L inverse of y, so we get that right there. And indeed, we can add first and then transform, or we can transform first and then add. And therefore, we know that the inverse of a linear transformation is itself a linear transformation. Now, why is that important? Well, the instant we know that L inverse is a linear transformation, then we know that if it exists, a matrix that represents it exists. So we know that there's some matrix, and let's call that matrix A inverse, the inverse of matrix A. What do we know? We know that if we take any x in Rn, if we apply the inverse function first and then the function, we get x, or if we apply the function first and then the inverse function, we also get x. And therefore, it has to be the case that A times A inverse is the same as A inverse times A times I. Why? Because matrix-matrix multiplication represents composition of the corresponding linear transformations. So here's a theorem, and it says that if L is a linear transformation and A is the matrix that represents it, then if there is a matrix B such that A times B is equal to the identity, then L has an inverse, and B is the matrix that represents that in that linear transformation that is the inverse. So what does that mean? That means that if L is a linear transformation and A is a matrix that represents L, then L has an inverse if and only if there exists a matrix B that is the inverse of A. And we also know that if A times A inverse is I, then A inverse times A must be I. Now, here's an important definition. These are two key words that we're going to be using quite a bit in the rest of the semester. One is the word invertible. So a matrix A is said to be invertible if its inverse exists, And another name for the exact same thing is that A is non-singular. As the semester goes on, we're going to make a long list of equivalent statements about A, and we're starting that list right now. So all of these bullets here are all equivalent statements about A. A is non-singular if and only if A is invertible, if and only if A inverse exists, if and only if A times A inverse is equal to A inverse times A is equal to the identity, if and only if A represents a linear transformation that's a bijection, if and only if A times X equals B has a unique solution for all B and Rn. So these are all equivalent statements, and as the course goes on, we're going to add to this list. Now conversely, A is not non-singular, and we say that by saying that A is singular, if and only if A is not invertible, if and only if A inverse does not exist, if and only if there is no inverse such that A times A inverse is equal to the identity, if and only if A does not represent a linear transformation that's a bijection, if and only if AX equals B does not have a unique solution for all B in Rn. So there's the notion of A being non-singular, and there's the notion of A being singular. A is invertible, or A is not invertible.